Hi, I'm Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and I've been a faculty member for over 5 years. I wanted to talk today about advice I have for students applying to graduate school. I've done a few videos on this theme so far, and a recurring topic on this theme is contacting your potential PhD advisor. That can be very scary, and there are more or less effective ways to do that. So I wanted to give you my tips for contacting professors in a way that will be more likely to engage them and have them begin a dialogue with you to see if you would be a good fit for working with them and if you would like to work with them as well. The truth is that when you're applying to PhD programs, it is just as important that the advisor likes working with you as you like working with the advisor. So in many ways, this is an audition for both parties to see if this is an engagement you would like to partake in for 5 years. That seems like a long time, a 5-year commitment, maybe 6-year commitment. The truth is that it goes by fast, but that is a lot to undertake. So the first thing that most students think of is a cold email. When you're thinking about different advisors and trying to figure out how to contact them, that seems like the easiest thing to do. Now, the problem with that is because it's easy, everyone does it, which means that some professors, very famous professors, are getting hundreds of these cold emails from students, and they all look the same. I'll be honest. There, somewhere on the internet is a template or form, and the standard email that I get from probably 65% of students is identical. So it's clear they're emailing me as well as, I don't know, dozens of other professors to try to find who is interested in them. And that can make sense. You might be inclined to take a similar approach, which is a shotgun approach. Apply everywhere, as many emails as possible. That's fine. I'm encouraging you to take a different approach, which is targeted, very thought out communication. Rather than going wide, focus in on true connections with people and trying to build that in a sincere way. I find that's most successful on me. That has been the most successful when I was doing that as an applicant as well. So I want to show you some tricks for how to do that. And we'll start with that email, okay? Because you're probably going to email people anyway. I'm not saying not to email, but there's different flavors of this. So I wanted to show you two types of emails that I often see. Let's start here with the one on the left. So basically you have, dear professor, I hope this message finds you well. You give your name, you're applying to this program, this degree, etc. So this is just an introduction. Then it says a little bit about a brief mention of your academic interests relevant to CS, and then brief mention of a project area of interest to the professor. Okay. In addition to my academic background, you have a brief mention of any relevant projects, and then specific relevant projects to the research or collaboration. Then the rest is why you're applying to this university, mention a strength of the department, university name, and then they always end with, I would be grateful for the opportunity to discuss interests that align with your ongoing projects, okay? And then you include your CV. You might be looking at this and say, oh, this is pretty good, right? This has all the relevant information, and sure, it's probably fine. This was created by ChatGPT, and this is pretty much the stock email that I get as graduate season application picks up. I'll get 10 of these a day, formatted exactly the same. So the problem with this is that it doesn't reflect a sincere interest in your research program, and it doesn't help differentiate any of the students. If everyone's sending this exact email, it is so hard to know who to spend time on. And often they're requesting for this opportunity to meet and discuss, and always that is included in a letter. You know, and if I were to do this, I'll get 100 of these emails a year. That means I'm spending 100 hours just trying to figure out who I would like to talk to. What it doesn't necessarily communicate is a thoughtful, deep understanding of my research program. I know you can add little bits through here, but what this is inclined to have students do is to mention a keyword about a professor's research, which isn't bad. You should mention something relevant about the professor's research, but also just kind of list skills that they have, and list projects that they've worked on. That can be useful, but it is really hard to translate the projects that you've worked on in the past to the work that I'm currently doing or the professors are currently doing, especially if we're talking about doing this for 100 people. That means you have to think deeply about how these things apply, okay? So in some ways, you want to do that work for the advisor. Here's an alternative version. Notice that it's much shorter, okay? We have the same kind of introduction here, but it already starts to get into some more specifics about the particular research that this advisor is doing. In particular, it will mention a specific paper that you will have read, that's important, and a specific thing within that paper that you are interested or inspired by. And ideally, you can expand this paragraph to be more about the ideas that you found fascinating in that paper, things that you might want to expand on, areas that you might want to explore, even questions that you've had about the paper. That would be fantastic if a student wrote me and said, oh, I read your research paper. Here are three questions I have about it. Ah, that would be fantastic. And then the student gets into more very detailed specifics about how their previous work brings in something new to this researcher that will help specific projects that they are working on. So that's what this paragraph is here. The next is a closing line, and this can be kind of generic, but the important part is asking if the advisor is currently accepting students. This email on the left sort of assumes that that's the case. That is truly not always the case. It might be the fact that you're not getting a email back because the advisor is not even accepting students. So, you know, it would be a lot of work to reply to people who are applying to jobs that don't exist, honestly. So the first part is asking if the advisor is accepting students and then helping to inquiring if they'd be a good fit or to discuss if they would be a good fit for the lab and the ongoing research. It's also shorter, which I think can be useful if you can be short and succinct and don't have any filler at all. Because basically an advisor will just kind of skim through this trying to find the relevant information. It's just chock with the relevant information to their work. That is really going to be a lot more successful. The other thing that this letter on the right communicates to me is that a human wrote this. There's often certain types of language that ChatGPT or other types of templates put together. The more you can sound like a person and convey who you are, the better, and that will help differentiate you from other individuals. So this is just a simple example of two types of communications via email and how I think one would be more successful than another. And of course, all professors and advisors are different, but I just want to warn you that if you're sending an email like this, you're going to be among hundreds of people doing the same thing. So you want to differentiate yourself to some degree. Now, before I move on, you might say, okay, well, how do I actually go about getting to know this person's work? And that is really the key, is to knowing deeply an advisor's work before you apply to work with them. So what I wanted to show you is just how to work Google Scholar a little bit. If you've never been introduced to Google Scholar, you probably have, but here's just a little primer on how to look up someone's research. For example, I'll look at my friend Arvind, who's at MIT. Let's say I'm thinking to apply to work with Arvind. So this is his Google Scholar profile. If I click here, it'll take me to his picture, his contact information, here are all of his citations. Down here are all of the co-authors that he's been publishing with recently. So if you like Arvind's work, you will probably like the work of these individuals as well. Now, when you are trying to get acclimated to someone's research program, it can be very overwhelming. Arvind has hundreds of publications, of course. So my pro tip for you is to look at the sort function. If you click on this year here, it will resort all of his citations to be based on the newest ones. So you want to look at the newest work that he's publishing and try to see what trends or themes are here. If you're just scrolling through this, you can look at words like accessibility pops up, data representations, accessibility's popping up again, some more of this grammar of graphics related work. So these are these kind of themes that are occurring in his research. So what you'll want to do is try and find some papers that are within that theme. And then if you click on it, it will show you the full citation, a description, and give you a location where you can read that paper. I recommend reading at least 5 papers from an advisor, in part because that is the work that you are going to be doing. You are going to be part of publishing this, and you will be an author on one of these papers, which is great. So you need to be in the practice of reading papers. And if you're applying to work with someone, you should really, really know their work like the back of your hand so that you can make an informed decision if you do want to work with that person or not. Because the truth is that you might dislike all of Arvin's work or my work, and you wouldn't know that unless you've read a great deal of these papers. Okay, let's talk about how else you might want to contact an advisor. This is really just advice so far about how to write a nicely constructed email. Another way to do it is to get an introduction by someone who might know that person. And that is really, really useful. The truth is that if you're going and planning to be in graduate school, you probably should have been doing some research previously. Usually we're talking about your sophomore year, you're starting to get into research and you're joined a lab or a particular group by your junior and senior year. So you should have some experience under your belt. In that process, you should be making connections with your advisors in your undergraduate programs. Academia is smaller than you think, and especially if you're applying to be in a program that's very similar to the work that you've been doing in the past, odds are your advisor knows whoever you're considering applying to work with. So getting an email introduction from that person to the individual who you're applying to work with is a great idea. And I think that's why it's also very important throughout your entire life to be nice and make friends and do good work. That's in part so these people can help make connections when you're looking to find new opportunities. If you're an excellent student, a joy to work with, very hardworking, they're gonna be so excited to kind of forward your information to an advisor. And that should really be one of your major goals throughout your entire life, is to make friends and connections that way. But think about your undergraduate degree as an opportunity to do that as well. All right, the next way that you might consider interacting with an advisor is at conferences. I love conferences. Different people have different feelings about conferences, but it is an opportunity where there will be a lot of people in the fields that you're thinking about going to all in one place. So some really good money spent is going to one of these conferences, especially if it's in your area. A lot of conferences migrate around from year to year. So take a look at the conferences that are relevant to the work that you want to do. And if it happens to be anywhere in your area, absolutely go. Even if you have to pay out of pocket, it will produce quadruple back to you by just meeting individuals. And what I recommend doing is going to their talks, trying to connect with them at coffee times, which is usually in between talks. That's where everyone is just sort of mingling. And what you want to do is ensure that you've read some of those papers or went to their talks. And if you see them at a coffee time, walk over and say, you know, I just want to say thank you for this paper. I found it really exciting and inspiring. I'd love to know more about this aspect of it. The key is that you know something specific about the work, showing a true, sincere interest. And that's really all the advice that I've been giving you today is try to show a sincere interest and be sincerely interested in someone's work and someone's program, and that will be a lot more beneficial to you. But if you do go to one of those conferences, definitely work the conference as much as possible. Sometimes they even have opportunities to volunteer as a student volunteer. That will really help you broaden your network, and you might end up meeting current PhD students in a particular person's lab, and so you can get to know more about the culture of that lab through that experience, and that might be a good inroad as well. So try to go to conferences if you can, if they're in your area, and it will give you a flavor of what it's like to be an academic. Okay, last but not least in terms of how do you contact a potential advisor is one that I see rarely used, but is so effective if you're brave enough to do it. So I thought I would include it here for those of you who are extra brave. And this is to ask to visit the advisor's lab, okay? So you might travel around, you might have family in different areas. If you happen to be traveling through a place, or if this university is local, you can send an email different than the one I showed you here today, really just asking if you could come visit the lab. And oftentimes they'll be so excited to have you come by, show the lab to you, connect you with some graduate students. And that individual one-on-one time is huge. The trick is that you have to go there physically and you have to be the one doing the work to kind of make that FaceTime. Now, of course, it's not practical to fly all the way around the world, to 3 or 4 places. I'm not suggesting doing that. But if you happen to be in a city where your potential advisor is, it doesn't take anything to shoot an email saying, I really love this paper. I'd love to talk to you more about it. Would there be any option to come visit your lab and just take a brief tour? Usually they're very, very open to that. And that shows an extra commitment and a level of enthusiasm. I hope that's helpful. I'm sorry if you've been emailing many professors, not getting many return emails. The truth is that it is hard game out there. You're competing against hundreds of amazing, super qualified students. So don't take it personal if you're not getting any return emails. Hopefully I've given you some tricks and tips to help increase your odds. But truly I say, lower the number of emails that you send out and try to put a lot more value and sincere interest to individual emails, and that should be more successful to you. If you like these types of videos, please comment below on topics that you'd love for me to cover in the future. I find these to be very interesting, in part because I give this advice over and over again to many students every year, and if you don't know, you don't know, and that is completely okay. There's no shame in having done some of the practices that I've talked about in this video. Hopefully I can just help guide you along and help you be more successful in your career. Take care.